So we've been talking about the fact that the Rushlikon conference and the framework notion came after a period of developments in the 1980s. And then it speeded up through the 1990s with people working together, having agreed that a framework at this time is now desirable, whereas before it was not perhaps the right moment. Many people see the 1990s, and several have commented, that there was a convergence of activities, therefore, between different bodies who perhaps had come up with the similar ideas, finding that they could work together around the similar theme of establishing levels and describing learning and teaching objectives. What's your view on that?
Well, I always felt that educational reform and development is a long-term process.
Yeah.
That there's been a danger, particularly, I think, in America, for new ideas to come along at 5-yearly intervals and to rubbish everything that had gone before, as a result of which there isn't a steady progress, but rather a fashionable transition from one set of ideas to another, while traditional practices continue really undisturbed.
Mm-hmm.
I think to get effective educational reform, you have to have a set of clear objectives and to pursue them consistently over a long enough period of time for them to penetrate an essentially conservative teaching profession. Mm. And so the effect of the shift of emphasis from linguistic form to linguistic function
mm-hmm.
was cumulative.
Mm-hmm.
To be effective, you've got to have working together with the same basic approach, learners, teachers, teacher trainers, textbook authors, and assessors and examiners.
What you're flagging up here, it seems to me.
And that gradually came about, partly because we did what we could always to bring the different interests together
right.
in symposia and workshops, and partly by the natural development of the field itself. And that became, I think, very clear at the beginning of the 70s. It was a relatively small group of people backed by important interests, but relatively small within the overall field. Quite a considerable part was played by the series of about 72 workshops which we held in the 80s and 90s, bringing together these different interests and centered on changing the atmosphere in teacher training. Mm. But I can't claim that we were the only force involved.
No.
And of course, the development of the can-do idea within ALTE and within can-do level statements were important in our thinking so that we incorporated them in the framework itself as appendices.
Yes. Sorry, I was interrupting before, but it occurred to me that what you were talking about around these activities which were happening was the value of a framework, not simply a series of levels, which some people see as the main contribution, but a way of encouraging collaborative activity around some shared notions and some shared ways of working.
That is central.
Mm-hmm. And the other thing you've just picked up on, I think, which is the convergence of activities which, to some extent, started separately, such as the ALTE framework, more or less emerging at the same time as the Rushlikon conference, but then finding convergences in the way that people began to think and interact, so that the Alte Kandu project and the scales that Brian North developed were somehow compared and in a sense converged as a result of what happened.
Yes, of course you will remember that when I was a Cambridge syndic, there were only two examinations.
That would be the first certificate.
That was the certificate of proficiency, which was designed to ensure that people coming from other countries to study in Cambridge could do so without any linguistic deficit. And the lower certificate, which was aimed at practitioners like bilingual secretaries and the like, who wanted a good command of the language for practical purposes. And even in my day, the officials of the syndicate were opposed to any enlargement of that scheme. There was no concept of a chain or a ladder which would guide the progress of learners from their initial learning stages up to their full proficiency. And that enlargement of the scope of the Cambridge examinations took place, I think, in the from the early 80s onwards.
Well, you might remember the first time that I met you professionally was when you and Jan van Eck had been revising the threshold and wastage at the end of the 80s, partly at the request of ourselves in Cambridge and the British Council, in relation to a new course which was coming out at those levels, and the intention that Cambridge had to produce a revised preliminary English test and introduce a new test at the wastage level, and needing an updated version of those specifications of objectives on which to base the exam syllabus, if you like, the guidelines for setting the standards and the content.
Yes, indeed. In fact, the whole development of a series of levels, starting with a threshold and then going down to wastage and then eventually to breakthrough and upwards to vantage, did not take place because we wished to set up a level system, but in each case as a result of the insistent demand of the field for these developments.
Right.
So that the I can't claim that the idea of levels was new, but we were ourselves rather skeptical about the notion of level, because we were very aware of the different directions in which language learning can occur.
In this case, we being the team working in Strasbourg?
The team working in Strasbourg on the unit credit scheme.
Right.
We illustrated, David Wilkins and also to a limited extent myself, on what a series of levels might look like in can-do terms. But we did not incorporate them into the overall framework scheme itself. That came later, but it came not as a result of an intellectual change so much as the requirements, the practical requirements of the field itself. People needed these things, and that need was stronger than our intellectual reservations.